the moment that I truly believed was at that live online conference when people were talking about it. And I just got that passion and that belief that this is something we can do. Mm-hmm. I started putting some plans together. I learned a lot about how the syndication process worked. I learned about conservative underwriting. I learned about, got some introductions into what it looks like to create a platform and how you work with investors, the rules and regulations with raising private money. And I fell in love with it.
Hey there, welcome to Make It Rain, Multifamily Real Estate Investing for Millennials. I'm Luke.
And I'm Daisy. And with every episode, whether we're discussing a special topic or have an amazing guest,
the goal is to provide education and resources for anyone interested in investing in multifamily real estate, especially if you're a millennial.
Yes, we're excited to chat with you about the what's, the whys, the hows, and the whos. Enjoy the show.
Welcome back, everybody, to Make It Rain, Multifamily Real Estate Investing for Millennials. This is Luke.
And this is Daisy. And today we're excited to have somebody who we've actually met online. And we've just had awesome conversations back and forth. And, you know, you meet people and you feel like you know them. And this is one of those guests. So welcome to the show, Rodney Robinson.
Thank you, guys. I'm super glad to be on and looking forward to discussing with you.
Awesome. Awesome. And before we jump into, you know, all the regular questions that we always talk about, as you know, being a listener yourself, Rodney, we want to get a little bit more personal. So if you don't mind sharing with our audience a nickname that your closest circle calls you, whether childhood or from adulthood, whatever is best for you.
Oh, that's good. I like that. Well, my kids call me Dad, and my wife calls me Sweetheart. And then those really, really close to me call me Rod. So very simple. But that's my close circle.
Nice. Okay. Very cool.
cool. Well, would you be able to just kind of walk us through your story and really how you got to where you are today, Rodney?
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. So I've always been interested in real estate investing and growing a business. In college, I invested in stocks while working and going to school. And I actually got an opportunity to be a leasing agent my first year of college at one of the top student housing communities in, you know, that university area that I was in. So that was really good hands-on experience. And I had no idea that it was going to be such an instrumental role in the future. It was just a job. It paid my rent and got me a paycheck. I also, after that time ended, I was trying to find a career, and being a marketing major, minor in economics, and with one of the local defense organizations there, I had an internship that led me to stay in that industry. So my whole working professional career, I've been in supply chain. And, you know, I was investing in stocks. And one day I said, I want to do something different. I want to do something that gives me control. So I came across some blogs and some podcasts and learned a lot about real estate investing. Mm-hmm. We bought our first house in 2016. We bought a rental property in 2019. The first house became the second rental. And in 2020, when the pandemic hit, it, you know, obviously not being great for so many people, it did afford some opportunities, such as me diving into multifamily real estate. Mm-hmm. So I went on to one of the podcasts where it was advertising the first ever virtual event conference for syndications. And I got hooked, and I'm still high on the momentum from that time. It was last July. It's almost a year from that point. And since then, I've been learning everything I could, networking as much as I could, started a blog, and, you know, did a lot of things that allowed me to position myself to be able to buy multifamilies and do my first apartment syndication. Today, I'm an LP and a real estate fund opportunity. And from this point, I just want to keep taking those steps to, you know, being in the business.
Yeah, that's awesome. So many takeaways for me. And one big one for me, Rodney, is going back to, you mentioned starting when you were in college, right? I'm assuming that was probably as an RA, a resident assistant.
Very close. We worked with the resident assistants. I was a leasing agent, but we had very similar duties.
Ah, okay. Very cool. And the reason that stood out to me is because my brother is now starting high school. He just finished, starting college. He just graduated from high school. And one of the things that we've talked about is him being an RA, right? Working on campus, on a college campus within the housing department, and it's a way for him to not have to pay for housing. I never thought about that translating into a skill set into multifamily or real estate until now that you mentioned it. And I think it's so important because being millennials, right, housing in college is a big hurdle, I think, especially now with the cost of tuition and how things have gone. So I appreciate you pointing that out because it's not something we've talked about yet on the podcast and something for sure, you know, whether you yourself have children or know anybody that does, a way to get into real estate at a very young age without being in real estate, but have that experience. Mm-hmm. So I love that you shared that in terms of your start and then going now into when you started purchasing your single family homes. Can you walk us through the process of what that looked like for you? You know, from the time you decided I'm going to buy and then, you know, rented that one out, bought the next one. What were those steps, those actionable steps that you took to be able to get there?
I'll tell you, in my head, I realized that every goal that I had, being huge as it was not actionable. So I got to a place where I was frustrated with like, dude, it's just not going to happen until you do something, till you say, this is what I'm going to do in 6 months. So naturally we did end up buying a house in 2016. We knew it was going to be a rental. So we wanted something that made sense from a price perspective, made sense from a space and location perspective. And that was going to be a great rental. So we knew we had that one situated for when we eventually move out and that becomes a rental. But I wasn't satisfied with that because everyone has a home. And it wasn't really, you know, the path to growing a real estate business or a rental property portfolio. So I was listening to a podcast and it was the same stuff we all know. You know, we tend to set our goals high. We don't take the action steps. You know, we overestimate what we can do, you know, and over time, and we underestimate our near-term steps and the massive action. So I put together a plan. Normally I just start talking to my wife. She's more of the thinker, but I actually did something different. I put together a plan, let's say 30 days, 60 days, 6 months to a year. And I told her, and I was just about in tears. I was like, I don't know how this is going to happen unless we actually do something. So I said, over the next 60 days, I think I said 6 months, I'd like to have a rental property. And over the next 60 days, I want to look and find something. And it was within 30 days, we had gotten our rental property. We identified something. It wasn't the best, but it was a step. I knew it was going to cash flow and it worked. And, you know, something we have to remember is that first step isn't, you know, your life doesn't change, but you really do create that momentum towards the big vision and the big picture. And that's how it worked out for us. That first rental property, we bought it. I took a loan from my 401k to help with the down payment. We had some cash reserves that we put aside towards, you know, fixing it up. And within 2 months, we had our first renter and we got consistent rent payments from that point on. So it was a great proof of concept.
There you go. And how have you gone about managing your portfolio that you and your wife have together here?
So it was very simple because there were two single families until I decided to focus and shift to multifamily. But I was self-managing for a while. And, you know, as you may know, you can work in your business or on your business. It's hard to work on your business if you're working in your business. Last year, I did something that I think was, it was groundbreaking for us. So I got a PM. I had great systems. And this is where it ties back to my leasing days. Because I worked in leasing, I used to administer leases. I used to resolve problems with residents, and by residents, I mean their parents because it's student housing. And we did tours. We did all types of things. So I did all that. I actually enjoyed it when we first, you know, secured our first two rentals with, you know, the tenants, the residents we had and still have. But something I learned in economics is even though you're good at doing something, there are other people that could do it for you so that you can put your, you know, your skills and talents to better use or more productive use. So I said, let's find a PM. This actually was a PM that I used when I was a renter. And it's very cool that it worked out that way. She's like, wow, it's awesome that you were a resident with us and now you're an owner with us. And, you know, I think it's a good reminder of what you can do in a short amount of time. To answer your question, we now have a PM and it's pretty much hands off. I do have to do what we would refer to a multifamily as asset management. Basically, I work with them to make sure that if there are maintenance requests, the expectations are set for understanding what caused certain issues and letting me know what my expectations are for when, you know, you notify me and when work will get done with or without my approval. So different things like that. And I love that. I feel like it's building a team. And now I want to implement that, you know, towards larger scale real estate.
Yeah, I think you bring up a good point, that something that people always come to eventually, but being more explicit about it, really, you're good. You're probably potentially very, very good as a property manager, right? And so this insource versus outsource idea, it's like, well, should I keep doing it or not? But really, it sounds like the opportunity cost of spending your time doing property management, even though that's like a source of expertise for you, it wouldn't be able to benefit you long-term to be able to constantly be spending your time doing that, as opposed to building out other parts of the business as you were talking about, right?
You're exactly right. And I'll say this. So even though I didn't spend much time managing the properties, because we had good residents, which I made sure we got good residents. We screened them. We did background checks. We did credit checks. I called every reference I had. Even though I only spend, let's say, 2 to 4 hours a month tops spent when I was self-managing, I knew it was better to get a PM. And here's an example. Last week, we had just three situations. Two were maintenance requests. And if I were being the working professional I am, were to get those three calls in that short amount of time, that would have been really frustrating for me. And I would not have been able to work on my day job and continue to do the consistent efforts I have with the multifamily business. And it would have drained me out. I would have been super discouraged last week. So just like you said, you know, in my case, I think I do what I do well, but I had someone else, a great property manager, and now a great maintenance coordinator on that property manager, that calls me, sends the emails, and she's really good, probably better than what I would have done. Except, you know, we set those expectations early. And now, just like you said, I can focus in other areas.
And so you've kind of alluded to it here and there, right? You do work full time. You have a family of four children. So it's like, I guess it's a total family of six with you and your wife. And so how do you go about being able to, you know, you have the assets that you and your wife own together, then you're working on building up this multifamily business on top of being a husband, father, and a full-time employee within the supply chain industry?
Yeah. I'll tell you what I've done. It's hard. It's easier now because my wife and I, we talked about the arrangements that we'd make and the system. Number one, I had to prove to myself that I was serious. And then I had to prove to other people close to me that I was serious. So because we have young children, our youngest two are twins and they're 2 years old. And as you can imagine, their behavior is not predictable sometimes. As they grow, they're in different seasons. They wake up at different times. So I had to do something radical. And I started getting up at 4 a.m. every Monday through Friday, every morning from Monday through Friday. And when I say that, sometimes I have off days, I get up later, but generally 98% of the time, Monday through Friday, I'm up at 4. I have a morning routine that includes working on the multifamily business. In the past, it was writing the blog posts and building my platform. Now that that's a lot smoother, it's now looking at deals and building a team. And doing that consistently since last July, nearly a year, proved to myself that we're making this happen regardless of circumstances. We're not going to make excuses. And then also to my wife. And my wife is also getting up at 4, working her routine. And that helps our personal life, you know, get established so that we're ready for the day and we're not just reacting to the day. And then, you know, you just have to, working remotely has created some pretty cool opportunities because now I'm closer to the ability to transition from work to personal life or from work to your business is a lot quicker. I don't have to commute anywhere. So that has helped in a big way also.
Yeah. Wow. That gave me the chills when you were saying, you know, you're so aligned, right, with your wife and, you know, the goals and the future that you want to have for yourselves and for your children. I think that's amazing, Rodney. And when you're able to have that sort of alignment with your significant other, I think everything else flows from there, right? You obviously have to take the action. You're waking up at 4 in the morning together, right, to work on what you know, you need to work on. But tell us a little bit more about how that came about, because that's very much so what I'm hearing is a mindset, right? It's you decided that you committed, right? You made a commitment that this is what you were going to do together, and this is what it was going to take. How did you come to that place of your life to say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to wake up at 4 a.m. What was that mindset piece that potentially shifted at that moment for you?
So ever since probably high school, I just knew that I wanted to grow up the corporate ladder. That was just what I knew I wanted to do. It was my vision to become a senior vice president, CEO of some large corporation, Fortune 500 organization. Then when we had children, things started to change. It didn't mean I was less ambitious, but it meant that maybe I have to be honest with myself, but I don't want to continue to have this type of responsibility. So for the last 10 years, I've been growing. I went from, you know, an individual contributor in the supply chain organization to having a team of 6, to suddenly having a team of 40. I took changed companies. And then I think last year in this new company that I was in, I realized that this is a very hard thing to do. And it's not where my desires are to continue to grow within an organization. I was a senior manager in that team. We had a team of 20 people. And what I realized is I wanted to, and that was the same time that I started to build the multifamily business, the whole thing with my desires for scaling the business. But I knew that in my work life, something had to change. So I recently did change jobs, and I came back to my old job, a company that I worked at twice in the aerospace and defense industry. I have a smaller team that I manage. I love it. I'm working virtually. I have value that I'm adding to the team, but that has helped me to realize that growing up the corporate ladder is good for many people if that's what they want to do. But sometimes you just have to be honest. So what I would tell millennials is, you know, we've been told, you know, go this certain path, and the higher you go, the better. And what I realized is some people, even the people that reported to me, they're more free because they're going on vacations. They're not stressing about money. They feel like they're adding value at their job, and they're more free than, you know, let's call them the big wigs in the organizations. And that's not to take away from anyone that loves what they do and loves growing in the organization. What happened for me was a major mindset shift that had to do with passive investing, but also had to do with time, which is a resource that we cannot get more of.
Yeah.
Unlike money, which is something we can get more of. So time, I place so much more value on than I ever have over the last year and a half.
It's you know, it's kind of like you start out like you're younger, you're graduating from high school, you're in college, and you have all these ideas in your head. And some of those things do end up being the case 10, 15, 20 years down the road. But for so many of us, things end up shifting as you get older and you have more life experience, you have more context around what, you know, really what life is as you mature into being an adult, and you have a different perspective on things.
Yeah. And what matters most, right? So I'd love to ask you, what is the why for you? You mentioned, you know, your family briefly. I'd love to get more insights into, you know, why you're doing everything that you're doing and where you see that going forward.
Yeah, that's a good question. I was thinking about it right before this opportunity to talk to you guys. You know, I put myself in so many uncomfortable situations outside of work. It's like with work, you have to step up, right? But I could be doing anything right now. I could be watching TV. I could, but this is what I love to do. And there's a picture right here of my family. And, you know, I hope they continue to grow our business, Robinson Capital, down the road. But I think the bigger thing is I want them to live a life that's true to them. I don't remember exactly the source, but this lady had spent a lot of time with people in hospice, and they had 2 big regrets consistently. And it was one of the bigger ones. The biggest one was staying true to yourself. And I think especially in this country where there's so much opportunity and the social media and things like that, it causes you to push things that may not be your true desires. So the big why for me, obviously, I love real estate and I love growing a business, and I love the vision to own and manage multiple assets in, you know, create markets and help investors grow their wealth as well. But I think the bigger thing is, you know, being an inspiration to others to get the finances just out of the way, that whole financial roadblock, like out of the way, so they can focus on their true mission. And it may not have anything to do with growing a business. It could be starting a church or supporting a ministry or scientific research or math or anything like that. And I think, you know, we spend so much time with that financial burden in front of us and it hinders us.
Because it's like almost like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, essentially. It's, right. It's hard to get to self-actualization if you're worried or concerned about like basic resources and being able to live your life in that way.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So in that sense, right, walking through your journey, Rodney, in terms of where you are now, it's all brought you into the multifamily space, right? You mentioned earlier that you, had seen the virtual event, right? That when COVID hit and everything went virtual, is we had a similar experience in terms of, you know, COVID allowed us the opportunity to meet so many more people, right? Everything went virtual. And so there was so much more access for us once COVID hit because, right, everything was virtual. We were connecting with people all over the country, yourself included, right? You're in Florida. Right. And so to walk us through how you came into multifamily, what was that moment when you first discovered multifamily and why did you decide to pursue multifamily specifically? Yeah.
So I'll say, when I thought of real estate, even much younger, I always imagined multifamily. But when I thought of getting started, I always imagined single family homes. So I've had so many conversations. One person owned a lawn company growing up and he lived next door. And he's like, you know what you need to do? You need to get into real estate. And that was already in my head. And when he said that, I remember the vision of an apartment complex, you know? So it's always been multifamily. But what happened last year is I realized you don't have to necessarily start with a big portfolio of single family homes. If you have the tools, the resources, good coaching and good networking and team, a great team, you can be successful in multifamily. You can get into the business. And what happened was with all of that networking I started to do from last year, I met great examples of people such as yourself that are doing it, that are closing deals, you know, thanks to social media. I'm seeing it all the time. So I'm like, if they can do it, I can do it. What are they doing? What am I not doing? And so it's always been multifamily. The moment that it happened for me, the moment that I truly believed, was at that live online conference when people were talking about it. And I just got that passion and that belief that this is something we can do. Mm-hmm. I started putting some plans together. I learned a lot about how the syndication process worked. I learned about conservative underwriting. I learned about, got some introductions into what it looks like to create a platform and how you work with investors, the rules and regulations with raising private money. And I fell in love with it. And that's why I can write so much about it and I can talk about it for a long time. And I think my wife, she might get tired of me talking about it.
Yeah. If she gets tired of it, then you're probably doing the right thing because you're putting so much action into it, Rodney.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what kinds
always of, on my mind.
What kinds of like properties and deals are you focused on specifically? Like where's your strategy focused right now?
So I'm looking in the Southeast. I'm here in Florida and similar to you all in Texas. You know, there's a lot of interest and competition in this area. There's a lot of migration to Florida. I'm in, let's say, the Central Florida area. I'm in Melbourne, Florida. Primarily, I'd be looking for opportunities in Melbourne and Palm Bay, which is the Space Coast, which is a growing area right off of basically 95. There's a lot of opportunity for development and people are just moving here because of the industry, the aerospace and defense industry. So lots of jobs. I'm also looking in Central Florida and surrounding areas because Orlando is always going to be a big area, but there's migration outside of the city into some of these surrounding areas. And then also North Florida where Jacksonville is. And then a little bit beyond, you know, for the future, I'd like to identify great emerging markets in the Southeast in general. So
yeah,
those are the focus. And the criteria is pretty much smaller multifamily at this point. So 30 to 50 units. I think there's a better shot of getting into that space. Whereas a lot of the larger, you know, buyers are looking for the larger assets. And that's where it seems to be getting very tricky and competitive with, you know, the deals that, you know, they make.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. So then, you know, pivoting a little bit, what is the advice that you would give to, cause you're essentially my age, I think, we graduated right around the same time. Well, what would you end up giving to somebody who's our age, who hasn't started within multifamily or started within real estate, and they are looking to invest and grow their wealth and be able to provide income for their families here?
I would say, take it seriously, like really take the education seriously. I think people understand why it's important to invest, but they're not going to treat it like an emergency. I think right now we have some really great opportunities. It could be opportunities or it could be painful for some people with all this extra, you know, stimulus and the continued devaluation of the dollar over time. I think people can take advantage of investing in real assets and growing their wealth with this, you know, added surplus of money that we suddenly have. And going to markets that make sense for great returns. And the reason I say treat it like an emergency is because these opportunities aren't always here. So years ago, when I was listening to podcasts, people were talking about what they did during the Great Recession. And I was like, dang, I missed it. I wish I would have known and had the education back then. And it's not a blessing at all to be in a place like this, but this is a cycle and this is what happens. And I think, you know, if we do the right stuff, we can, you know, especially millennials that are prime in their working careers and their earning abilities, they can continue to push by growing in their careers and growing their income and creating a machine to where that earned income invests for passive income. There's less pressure on your work and you could work passionately instead of fearfully. So in summary, I would say treat it like an emergency and get educated and then talk to great people such as yourselves.
Yeah. Treat it as an emergency. That's not something that I'd heard before, Rodney. And, you know, I think you're right. People say, you know, the best time to invest in real estate was yesterday, right? Mm-hmm. And even now in Austin, right? We're in Austin. People say how high the prices are and, you know, people are overpaying. Yet in 2, 3, 5, 10, 20 years, they're going to say, oh, I wish I bought in 2021.
Exactly.
Right. And right. So it's just, you know, doing what you can with where you are and taking that massive action like you've been doing, you know, for quite some time and figuring out your skill set along the way, right? You mentioned, you know, your background has helped you a lot, right? In terms of having a certain value that you're able to bring to the table. And so I definitely encourage you listening, right? To do some research, do some introspective work, look at, you know, what you're good at, what you bring to the table, and then align yourself with somebody who's looking for that skill set exactly, because everybody has something that they're bringing to the table, right? And so as we get ready to wrap up, Rodney, I'd love to know from you, what do you feel is your greatest contribution to the world thus far?
I think my greatest contribution, you know, this probably goes back to my personal passions. There are a lot of people struggling, you know, not just in our country and not just other places. I think, you know, if you look at the news, a lot of people are going through some hard times between the pandemic and between just poverty in general. And I think people listening to this are all equipped to be a part of that solution. Mm-hmm. And whatever field that they're in or their expertise or their passion or investing in general. So, you know, the impact that I'm making is sowing where those needs are, you know, supporting ministries, supporting, you know, just needs for people that are just hurting right now. And part of the vision for growing Robinson Capital and growing our, and having a scale in the multifamily space is to be able to have a larger impact on not just residents that live in the communities we have, but also with the wealth that we create to be able to just help in those very important areas where people don't have the same opportunities that we have.
Mm-hmm. So. That's awesome. Well, it was great having you on, Rodney. We really, really do appreciate your time and energy. And I think that I think that listeners will get a lot out of it, not only because of, I think, your mindset, like you're very intentional, right? But then they can kind of look at your journey and where you are now and see themselves in your shoes as well, especially being a father and taking on the responsibility of that. And then making the time to be able to build everything up that you want to. And at this point, with that, where can listeners reach out to you, be able to learn more, get in contact with you and talk to Rodney Robinson II?
Thank you. Yeah, it's just that they can go to RodneyRobinsonSecond.com. That's Rodney Robinson with two I's, the Roman numerals.com. And you talked about the journey. That is where I talk about my journey, and I talk about the good, the bad, the frustrations, the things that I'm learning. If you go to the site, I also have a free gift, which is a passive investor startup guide. It's a 5-part guide that talks about what multifamily is, how syndications work, what it looks like to be a passive investor.
Yeah. Thank you for sharing that with our listeners. And I read your blog myself, and I, you know, will comment and say, oh, wow, this is happening, or congrats on, you know, X, Y, and Z. So definitely encourage you all to go follow and listen and support. And I'm going to sneak in one more question, just because I'm curious to know your children. They're, you know, your children and your wife, they're a big part of your journey, you know, and your why. You shared a little bit about that before. How do you explain to them what you do and what it is that you're doing within multifamily?
I wanted to show you when you asked that question. I don't have it. I think my wife cleaned up. Man, it is a picture that my daughter drew, my 7-year-old. And not here. Oh, man, I wish I had it. It's a picture she drew. And it says Robinson Capital. And it has these big apartments and some other writing on it. And I was almost in tears.
Yeah.
We talk, you know, when you're talking to a 7-year-old, you can give more detail than a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old, but we explain, you know, why it's important to be good stewards of finances. We explain how rental properties work. They're proud that we have, you know, 3 homes. But I explained to them that we're giving people an opportunity to live somewhere. Why don't they buy their own? Because some people don't have that opportunity to buy their own. Mm-hmm. So now they have a place that they can live. And when we invested in the fund, I explained, you know, mom and dad are growing, you know, our investments. And that's pretty much. So I think I'm not the best at it. Sometimes I go way over the top. My wife's like, you know, that's way too much for her. But I think it's just having the conversation and explaining it in a way that makes sense for them. They know exactly what our mission is.
That's I love awesome. That. Yeah, that's beautiful. Thank you for sharing. And I love hearing, you know, how parents that are in the space communicate that to their children. You know, Luke and I are to start having children in the next couple of years, God willing. And, you know, it's a big part of our journey, right? And we want them to be part of the process because that's the reason that we're doing all of this, right? It's to
that's
be able
great.
To, you know, create our life and our family around the business and have the flexibility to do that. So thank you for sharing and thank you for being on the show. I hope everybody got as much value from it as we did, because we always enjoy these conversations as well. And, you know, go follow the blog and see what Rodney's doing. And we'd love to have you on, you know, in the future once you've closed, you know, a massive number of deals and are in a very different, you know, space and have made so much action towards your goals on that end as well. So thank you so much, Rodney, and we'll definitely continue to follow and support your journey.
Thank you guys. It was an honor to be on the show. Like I said, loyal listener. So I appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Rodney. And with that wraps up another episode of Make It Rain, multifamily real estate investing for millennials. And with that,
make it rain,
make it rain.
Thanks for listening. The best way to show support is to share it with anyone who might benefit from it and leave us an awesome review.
Follow us on Instagram at Make It Rain Podcast and check us out on our website at MakeItRainPodcast.com for more goodies.
Take action on your financial future today. See you on the next episode.
See you soon.